A living epistle is a proof and an exhibit of the reality of God. A living epistle is a communication, a vessel of communication that brings to bear the mind of God, the will of God, the purpose of God, so that the government of God is established in his sphere of influence. And on the strength of this, we declared very authoritatively that is beyond talking about God. It is actually living as God. And looking at the context where we find ourselves and the context in which we were born, we saw that it would be literally impossible to live like God in a dark and a fallen creation. First, because we were born in sin. Secondly, because the world itself is falling. So what is that strategic intelligence that God has put in place to make a man who is born in sin into a fallen world to become an expression of God? This becomes the weight of the subject. Not just to declare that we are living epistles, not just to declare that we are supposed to be living epistles. Every one of us is aware of that. How do we become living epistles? Becomes the big challenge that confronts every one of us. When sin comes into your borders, what do you do about it to manifest the righteousness of God? Becomes the big challenge. The challenge is not to know that you are supposed to be the righteousness of God. How do you become manifestly the righteousness of God? Becomes the challenge. When the devil comes into the family, how do you become the expression of the power of God? Becomes the challenge. The question is not knowing what ought to be. The question is how to get what ought to be to become what is. And this is where many are challenged. This is where the devil oftentimes tries to make a mockery of our belief system. But there is a way. And we saw that the simplest and most accessible way of achieving this reality is by our interaction with the Word of God. The Bible said, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. It said, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. So if there is darkness, it means the believer have not become light by the Word. And if the believer have not become life, light, it simply means he has not made contact with life. Because until the life that flows from the Word becomes the experience of the believer, he cannot be a light in darkness. And we said many times, interacting with the Word of God becomes the challenge of the believer. We receive it graciously and sometimes even religiously, but we don't engage it. The Bible said in John chapter 1 verse 10 to 11 and 12, he said he came into the world, the world knew him not. Of course, the world cannot know him because the world is fallen. The world is alien to his reality. When Adam fell, creation and man rebelled. He said, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become the sons of God. And that is where most of us stop. We stop when we become the sons of God. So there is no experience. Legally, we are the sons of God, but experientially, we are expressions of different spirits apart from God. So you look at the sister dressed half naked and you say, what is your name? And she say, my name is Mary. You look at the brother, you say, what is your name? He was caught scamming on the internet and he said, my name is Christian. Legally, he has been born again, accepted Jesus, but experientially, his life is an expression of Babylon. His life is an expression of Jezebel. His life is an expression of Mammon, the god of commerce. What is the problem? God is supposed to be the most powerful. The Bible said all things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. And you have received the all-powerful God. How come you are still a puppet in the hands of the devil? The inability to engage the world. In verse 16, he said, we beheld him. The people that journey from legal reality to experiential reality, he said, we beheld him. And when we beheld him, we no longer saw the Logos. He said, we saw him as the glory of the Father, full of grace and truth. Others only received him and stopped, but some people went further. He said, we beheld. The moment we beheld, we began to see something much more than the Logos. Somebody has received him because they told him, for God so loved the world and gave his only begotten son. But somebody else, after hearing that and accepting that truth, sat on the truth and began to look upon it. How is this possible? And as he beheld, the Bible said the glory was made manifest. And Paul came in 2 Corinthians 3:18. He said, we all with unveiled faces. What unveiled our face is the acceptance of Jesus Christ. He said, for the law that was given on the mountain, even though the face of Moses shone, till this day the veil was upon them. But he said, as we turn to the Lord, the veil is removed. So when we received him, the veil is removed. But the irresponsibility of beholding to see the glory becomes the crisis of our life. He said, as we beheld him, we are changed from glory to glory by the Spirit, even to the same image. So the Holy Spirit, even though it's within, cannot walk until you behold. Because the Spirit begins to walk when the believer begins to behold. And we said when the believer beholds, something happens. He becomes the physical, the manifest expression of everything the God on his inside is. This is when the believer becomes a living epistle. When he's able not just to host God, but to give expression to God. And if this truly begins to happen in your life, then in eternity, you become an entity of recognition. This is where I want to get into certain implications. Because most times, we listen to doctrines, we master them, but we don't know the implication. Most times, it's possible, especially for the youth, to assume that everything about life ends in time. Paul said, if only in this life we have hope, we are of all men most miserable. Life is a ticket and an opportunity given to us to invest in eternity.